الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. My brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And I fast and I break fast and I marry woman. وَتِلْكَ سُنَّتِي. And this is my deen. The word sunnah here means deen. Sunnah and أهل الأصول. Deen, religion. And if you're not going to follow my deen, you're not my follower. Marriage, brothers and sisters in Islam, is something that we should seek, is something that we should go for. It is a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unfortunately, the subject today is not about marriage. I would love to go on talking about marriage, but the subject today, why then, if this is what marriage is, why then do we have so many divorces? I read something today. Every 6 minutes in the Muslim world, there is a divorce. The divorce rate reached 70% in some countries. Muslim countries. Muslim countries. Why? Why, brothers and sisters in Islam, why the divorce rate is skyrocketing in the Ummah? And it doesn't look like it's going down. The problem, it's going up. It's not even stopping. It's still going up, climbing, increasing. And, you know, I feel sorry for the youth, for the young brothers and sisters. Subhanallah, I see a lot of them here tonight somehow. Because they look at that experience and they say, why should I get married? Why should I go there if this is the end result? Today, inshallah, brothers and sisters, I'm going to mention 12 reasons. But I'm really mentioning the reasons to avoid them. I'm mentioning the reasons for the divorce, for you to avoid the reasons. Of course, you could come up with more than that, but 12, inshallah, will be sufficient, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Number one, making the wrong choice to begin with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you in the Quran, وَأَنْكِحُوا الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Marry the righteous, from your women and your men, from the women for the men, and for the women from the men. Don't look at their poverty or riches. Don't. If they are poor, Allah can turn them rich. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam translated this in a beautiful hadith that is agreed upon by Abi Hurairah, narrated by Abi Hurairah radiyallahu an, agreed upon by Al-Bukhari wa Muslim. تُنْكَحُ الْمَرْأَةُ لِأَرْبَعُ. A woman is asked for marriage because of four things. One, مَالِهَا or جَمَالِهَا, her physical beauty. She's a cougar, like they say. Huh? مَالِهَا. She has money. حَسَبِهَا, her lineage. And I would say with the lineage, her green card. You know, if you marry an American, you get the green card. And then the deen, the religion. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells you, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَاكَ. You better go with for the one with the deen. Otherwise, one of the best explanations for that word, taribat yadak, you're going to put sand in your head. A righteous woman, brothers and sisters in Islam. The Prophet ﷺ, and I narrated the hadith earlier, and the hadith has a completion. Hadith in Sahih Muslim. Hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhumah. الدُّنْيَا مَتَاعَ. This dunya is an enjoyment. And the best of its enjoyment is righteous women. A righteous woman. بالله عليك, ask somebody who is having a hard time with his wife. He will tell you, yes. In a wording, a different wording of this hadith with Ibn Majah, the narrator is Abi Umam al-Bahili رضي الله عنه. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned a couple of things about that rich, that righteous woman. He said this, إِذَا نَظَرْتَ إِلَيْهَا أَسَرَّتْكَ. If you look at her, she will please you. This is a righteous woman. وَإِذَا أَقْسَمْتَ عَلَيْهَا أَبَرَّتْكَ. And if you take an oath, by Allah, you cannot do this, she will say, okay, no problem. That's a righteous woman. وَإِنْ غِبْتَ عَنْهَا. And if you leave the house because you have to go somewhere, حَفِظَتْكَ فِي نَفْسِهَا وَمَالِكَ. She will guard you in herself. She's not going to go around. And she's going to guard your home, your house. Because she fears Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This righteous woman knows what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كما في حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه في صحيح ابن حبان. You know the righteous woman? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about her, إِذَا صَلَّتِ الْمَرْأَةُ خَمْسَهَا. If the wife prays her five daily prayers, وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَهَا, and she fasts the month of Ramadan, three, وَحَفِظَتْ فَرْجَهَا, and she kept herself chaste, وَأَطَاعَتْ بَعْلَهَا, and she obeyed her husband, she will enter Jannah from any of the eight gates of Jannah. If she does those four things. فَالصَّالِحَاتُ قَانِتَاتٌ حَافِظَاتٌ لِلْغَيْبِ. This is the type of woman you want to be with. A woman who fears Allah. A woman who wants to go to Jannah. Anything else less than that is trouble. That is why a lot of our marriages are not working. Because you married just for the physical beauty. You married just for the money. You married just for the family. No,
There is nothing wrong with having any of those, but not at the expense of the deen. I would love to have a religious, rich, beautiful, prestigious wife. 4-in-1. If you can get it, show me how so. That's a killer. But not at the expense of the deen. No. No. Don't. Not at the expense of the deen. Choosing righteous wife is a key. Like I, subhanAllah, and this goes also to the sisters and their guardian. في سنن الترمذي حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says to the guardian, to the fathers, إذا جاءكم من ترضون خلقه ودينه فزوجوه. If someone comes to you asking your daughters in marriage that you're content, you're happy, you're pleased with their manners and their deen, give them your daughters in marriage. Do that. إلا تفعلوا. If you do not do this, تكن فتنة في الأرض وفساد كبير. You're exposing your daughters to fitna. How many parents they do this now? I tell you, they hardly even check if the person prays 5 times or not. Oh, he has a good job. What are you going to get her? I'm going to get her a house. I'm going to write it for her. Don't betray your entrusts, dear parents. Don't.
I think I lost my ablution, but I'm not sure. Do I have to make wudu again? Is it allowed for Muslims to visit the graveyard, or is that shirk? Am I allowed to say Jummah Mubarak to someone? Can I get to know a sister before marriage? I have so many questions, and I feel that I've just reached a dead end. If only I could find someone trustworthy to answer my questions. Someone who speaks based on proof from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet.
والله قصة, a story out of this world, وسندها صحيح, and its chain of narration is authentic. One of the predecessors, وهو من سادتهم, يعني his name is سعيد بن المسيب, يعني somebody who actually met a lot of the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He had a daughter. الوليد ابن عبد الملك ابن مروان, the son of the Khalifa, wanted to marry her. The son of the Khalifa, What he said? He said no. One day, he used to give lectures like this. He used to teach. He missed one of his students, one of the regular students in his dars. His name is Abu Wada'a. And then he showed up 3 days later. And he asked him, what's wrong, Abu Wada'a? Where you been? I haven't seen you in 3 days. He said, my wife died and I was busy with her burial. And then he asked him, are you going to get married again? He said, وَمَنْ يُزَوِّجْنِي? Who's going to give me his daughter? I only have 2 dinar. 2 dinar like 20 bucks now. قَالَ أَنَا أُزَوِّجُكَ. I'll give you my daughter in marriage. And then he got the students, bear witness. Ask me to marry my daughter. إِنِّي اسْتَخَرْتُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى عَلَى الزَّوَاجِ مِنْ مُوَكِّلَتِكَ so and so عَلَى كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَعَلَى سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَعَلَى الصَّدَاقِ الْمُسَمَّى بَيْنَنَا 2 dinar. قَلْ زَوَّجْتُكَ. Abu Wada'a went home at night and then knock on the door. فَقَالَ مَنْ. He said, who is there? قَالَ سَعِيد. He said, سَعِيد. Abu Wada'a said, I thought of every other Sa'id but Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. Because for 40 years, the only 2 places that he knows is his house and the masjid. He never leaves the masjid, Masjid al-Nabawi. Never leaves the masjid for 40 years. He opened the door, Assalamu alaikum, and here is your wife. I don't want you, that you have a wife, and I brought her for you. Abu Wada'a, by the way, in the morning, he's waking up to go and to study with Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. The daughter is asking him, where are you going? He said, to go and learn from Sa'id. قَالَ تِجْلِسْ أَعْطِيكَ عِلْمَ سَعِيد. I will teach you the knowledge of Sa'id. Sit down. Ya Allah. This is real stuff, brothers. Real stuff. يعني أنت تعجب كما في صحيح البخاري لما تأيمت حفصة. حفصة the daughter of عمر بن الخطاب. When she became أيم. الأيم هو الأعزب. عبد الله بن حذافة السهمي. سيدنا عمر رضي الله عنه went to عثمان بن عفان asking him to marry his daughter, Hafsa. Sayyidina Uthman, amhilni, let me think about it. And he came back and he said, no, I'm not interested. He got Sayyidina Umar a little bit. And then he went to Abu Bakr, al-Siddiq. Marry Hafsa. He said, can you just allow me a couple of days, please? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Umar and he asked to marry Hafsa radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, and he married her. فأبو بكر came to Sayyidina Umar, قال له لعلك وجدت علي. I hope you did not get upset with me because I never came back to you with an answer. والله, by Allah, لقد ذكرها رسول الله أماني. شاف اللي the Prophet ﷺ mentioned her in front of me, that he's interested in her. And I was waiting. And I did not want to reveal the secret of the Prophet ﷺ. That is why I was waiting. الشاهد
There is nothing wrong. Because when you choose a righteous husband, when you choose a righteous wife, that person will fear Allah in your son or in your daughter. They do. But if you do not choose righteous people, they are not going to fear Allah. A righteous person will fear Allah regarding your daughter. When he does not love her, he will fear Allah in her. He will still fulfill her rights. The first problem, and this is, I tell you, the most serious problem, and it is the basis for everything, that a lot of Muslims, they do not marry people in the basis of the deen. Here is a little twist to this, and being practical. You end up marrying your wife, and your wife marrying you for other reasons than the deen. Because you fall in love and all that love story thing. And you never even address the issue of the deen whatsoever. After 2 or 3 years of the marriage, one of you will start transforming. You know the transformers that you get from McDonald's? But transform into the deen. By all of a sudden you find your wife wearing the hijab and she's reading the Quran. She's praying tahajjud. And you still what? Washy-washy with the deen. You don't even pray the 5 daily prayers. Or the other way around. You start getting to the masjid and meeting the people and your wife still doing her dunya things. Here's a big problem. That now you want your wife or you want your husband to transform like you right away. And you don't want to be patient. And a lot of the problems are like this. You went and you married your wives. You never discussed the religion. You never talked about it. Religion was irrelevant to begin with. I love you, you love me, we're happy family and all that stuff. Now the religion came in the picture. Now you want your wife to be religious tomorrow. And you want your husband to be religious tomorrow. Otherwise, let's break the relationship. La ya akhi, give her da'wah. Give her, be patient now. Remember, religion was not part of the picture. So be patient. Be patient. This is the first reason, inshallah. The second reason, and I really would like you to understand this. Marriage is an institution that will face a lot of challenges. It's not what you have watched in television. I'm sorry, but this is the reality. I know in the movies, in the soap operas, in the books, they tell you they got married and then they lived happily ever after. I'm saddened to say that sometimes they lived sadly ever after. I'm sorry. We need to, let's be realistic here, come on. The forces of evil, and I'll give you evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the children of Israel in the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to them Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the book and the message, they refused it, and then they followed what? وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانَ وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانُ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا. A beautiful verse in Surah Al-Baqarah called السحر, آيات السحر. You recite it to the person who has sorcery, somebody did some sorcery to him or to her. Look at this. They learn sorcery from Harut and Marut, the two angels. There is a story, long story behind this that I don't want to get in there. But look at this. فيتعلمون منهما ما يفرقون به بين المرء وزوجه. They learn sorcery in order to separate husbands and wives from one another. Because this is a devastating impact. Divorce is a destruction. The family is a block in a building, is a unit in a group of units. If you destroy these units one after another, you have no community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, He mentioned that they learn sorcery from a lot of sources, and they use it for so many things, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the one thing that is so harmful, that they learn sorcery to separate husband and wives. وصحيح مسلم حديث جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, every single day, every day, ya akhi, الشيطان places his throne on water, and he would give incentive to the little shayateen. Whosoever does the best job today in misguiding the Muslims, I will place the crown with my own hand on their heads. Look, at the end of the day, he would place his throne again in water. Very serious man, I mean, a very serious person. The Satan, he's serious about his business. I mean, the guy is punctual. Every day in the morning, the throne in water, at night, the throne in water. Okay, what did he do today, little shayateen? One of them will come and say, listen, I was able to get this person to kill this person. Good job. I was able to get this person to commit adultery. Good job. You name it. Major sins. Major sins. Until someone will stand and say, listen, today I was able to divorce a man, a husband from his wife. I was able to separate a husband and wife. If you're divorcing your wife without a legitimate reason, you're making the mission of Shaitan successful. Shaitan would call this person, this little Shaitan, come out here. Ni'ma ant, anta ant. You are the man. You are the man. Now think about this. Adultery is a major sin. Killing is haram. Stealing is haram. Divorce is not haram. Divorce is not haram. It's not haram, divorce.